today is All Saints Day. Depending on your faith background, I grew up in the Pentecostal church. We like didn't do any sort of holiday sort of things. And then I got involved with more of a traditional Lutheran church, and we did like a lot of things. But depending on your faith background, you may or may not have had much to do with this day in the past, and we're not really doing too much with it either here, but our text today goes on along with that theme, and so I just want to tell you a little bit about it. Basically, All Saints Day is the day in the church calendar that is set aside to remember those that have died in their faith. And, you know, it's a day for us to both thank God for the people that he gave to us, who passed down the faith to us, and also to consider afresh for how about how we are living our faith, how we are passing on the faith in our own lives. And so our text today, it comes from the book of Matthew as Jesus delivers what's traditionally been called the Sermon on the Mount. And this little section that we're considering today is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12, and it's further kind of categorized as the Beatitudes, the title of which comes from a Latin word meaning blessings. And so that's a little bit of the background on our text this morning. But before we read it and go through it together, I have a question for you. Who is the most beautiful person you have ever met? No pointing, no saying who it is, no those elbow things. Is it your spouse? Is it your high school crush? A celebrity? Your parents? Your grandparents? It's the most beautiful person you have ever met, your elementary Sunday school teacher. I guess it kind of depends on what we're talking about when we talk about beauty, doesn't it? You know, we've all known a lot of people who were very attractive physically, but were absolutely ugly in every other way, and then vice versa. And so here's what I want you to consider today in light of the text that we're going to cover. Who is the most beautiful person you've ever met? Or maybe we could think of it in another way. Who has been blessed by God more than anyone you've ever met? Because really, this is actually what is going on when we ascribe beauty to someone or something. We observe that there is something about that person or that thing that displays God's goodness more than other people or things that we encounter. So who comes to mind when you think of that? As we read in our text today, Jesus paints the picture of someone who is truly beautiful, someone who is truly blessed by God. And unfortunately, his description of this person is often very different from our own definition of beauty that we function on. But today, I encourage you to hear what Jesus says about what it means to be truly beautiful, to be blessed by God, and to consider whether or not we have a better understanding, or if he does, of what beauty is. And now, we aren't going to read our text in full prior to the sermon like we normally do, because we're just going to read it as we go verse by verse. But before we read and consider this together, let's take some time to pray. Dear Father, you have given us a beautiful life to live. I ask that we would receive it. I ask that we would receive the one who has given us this life. In your name we pray. Amen. So our text begins with Jesus going up on a mountain with his disciples. And he sees the crowds, and the picture we get is the crowd kind of gathered out as Jesus is up in a mountain, and the disciples are kind of sitting around, almost like a preacher with the children in front during a children's sermon. And he's talking to the children up front, which are the disciples, but then the crowd kind of gets to listen in on the whole thing. And that's kind of the scene that we have, verse 1 and 2. And then Jesus opens his mouth and he starts preaching the most important sermon that has ever been given. It's three chapters, 5, 6, and 7 in the book of Matthew. And today we're just covering the first 12 verses of that. But even still, with just this little amount that we're covering, the things that Jesus has to say are so deep that we could fill book upon book in our bookshelves just talking about it. I mean, Jesus lays out here a life that is truly blessed by God, and if we really received it, we would look very different. The first thing he says in verse 3 is, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Now, it's important to hear exactly what Jesus says here. He does not say that being physically poor is something good in and of itself, or that you will inherit eternal life if you are poor in this life. Instead, Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." So then the question is, what does it mean to be poor in spirit? It essentially means one thing that's expressed in two ways. To be poor in spirit means that we recognize that all that we have is a gift from God, and that we hold no ultimate ownership in anything. We have no rights to the things that we hold. And this works itself out in two ways. In a physical way, it means that we understand that every coin, every bank account, every ability, and every second of our lives belongs to God. And we ought to be willing to give back to Him what is rightfully His. This means that those who are poor in spirit will give freely to those who are in need. They will support the work of the kingdom of God. And they won't hold on to their wealth with clenched fists, but will instead treat their wealth as it really is, a temporary trust that they're holding on to be used for God's work. And that's the first way it plays itself out, to be poor in spirit. Here's the second. When someone who is poor in spirit considers themselves in light of their relationship to God, they see that they have nothing to bring to the table. And they can only respond to God in terms of grace. The only hope they have is God to be gracious. They can't bring any amount of good deeds that they do or prestige that they've acquired in the world in His sight. They recognize that it's by grace alone that they are saved. The poor in spirit don't hold on to the things they possess in this life with a clenched fist. They don't find their value in the things that they temporarily possess or have accomplished. They approach God in terms of grace, and they know that the kingdom of God belongs to them because God is a gracious God. And so if that's you today, if you are poor in spirit, Jesus says to you, "Blessed are you who are poor in spirit, for yours is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus goes on, verse 4. "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." And now this one sounds, it's just so odd when you think about what we all strive for in this life, what we hope for. You know, we work tooth and nail to make sure that we are well fed, that we are comfortable, and not in need in any way. Most of all, we hope that we're happy, that we're not in a state of perpetual mourning. We do all that we can to make sure that we're not sad. And yet, Jesus says, "Blessed," or "happy," are the mourners. So what's Jesus getting at? Why is it bad to avoid sorrow like the rest of the world? It's because there's something about mourning and being in sorrow that is central to the life of the Christian in this world. Luther once said, "Simply begin to be a Christian, and you will soon find out what it means to mourn and to be sorrowful." So if you're thinking, wow, I got to get my life in a happier spot, let me be a Christian. No. In this sense, Christians mourn more than anyone else in the world. And why is that? It's because as Christians, we see things as how they really are. We see the tremendous effects of evil on the world. And because of that, we are content to mourn the loss of all things, to call evil for what it is. Additionally, we don't cling to this life with clenched fists, but instead, so that we might live comfortably at all costs, we don't guide our lives in that way, but we instead are content to lose it all for the sake of the life to come. And I think that's the key point here that we need to take. Jesus is not saying that we should seek to continually mourn and you guys have a really great day. It's like, oh man, I gotta be sad. It's not what he's saying. He isn't saying that we need to continually mourn or be in a state of constant sorrow, but rather that we would remember that God is still our good God when we are in our times of mourning. He wants us to see that when things go badly for us in this life and we have to mourn, that we can know that our God is still good and that he longs to be gracious to us and that he will show us his goodness in the kingdom of heaven where we will be comforted. He tells us that we will all mourn in this life, but that there is a good way to mourn and that there is a bad way to approach mourning. Those who mourn in faith, knowing that God has given them the life that they are living, will be comforted. But on the flip side, those who seek to avoid all sorrow in this life by living for themselves will end up finding that there is no comfort for them in the kingdom of God when it comes in power. And so today, if you are a mourner, like Jesus says here, he says to you, "Blessed are you who mourn, for you shall be comforted." Jesus continues in verse 5. "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Now, meekness is not really a word that we use very much these days. And if you've heard it, you've probably heard it used in a way that's very different from what it's meant here. It's often used, when it is used, as a synonym for weakness. But meekness is anything but weakness. To be meek means that you have the ability and the right to defend yourself and to get back at someone for wronging you. But you don't. You choose to let it slide. To be meek means that you are not overly impressed with your own self-importance, but that you are humble and gentle at heart. And sometimes I can get caught in this trap on social media when someone takes something that I've said and then kind of twists it to mean something that I didn't say, and I get this intense righteous anger. It's not righteous. This intense anger rise up in me that says, I need to defend myself. They're lying about me. I need to show that person how foolish they are and how they have messed things up. Now, do I have the right to defend myself? Absolutely. But that is not the path of meekness. Instead, God calls me and he calls you in similar situations to turn the other cheek, to not be concerned with your own defense, but to instead leave that up to God and to his servants. But this is just the absolute opposite of the path that we naturally want to take. You know, we get so consumed with these power games that position ourselves over another person you know, never willing to let another person have the upper hand over us. But here's what Jesus says to us when we feel that need to defend ourselves. He says, you don't need to defend yourself. I will defend you, and you will inherit the earth. You don't get the kingdom of God by achieving it, but by receiving it. And so if that's you today, if you are meek, Jesus says to you, blessed are you meek ones, for you will inherit the earth. Jesus goes on in verse 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. So what does it mean to hunger and thirst for righteousness? Let's talk about what it doesn't mean first. It doesn't mean that we are called to go hide ourselves away off into some monastery or to separate ourselves off from the rest of society so that we don't encounter any evil in this world. It doesn't mean that we need to pull our kids out of public schools, to send them to Christian colleges, or to shelter them from ever hearing certain words or seeing certain things. Now, you know, there may be other reasons for some people to homeschool their children. I was homeschooled. Julia was homeschooled. It was awesome for us. There may be some reasons for that. Or there may be some good reasons to send your kids to Christian colleges. We both did. It was awesome. Or we haven't sent our kids to Christian colleges yet. They're kind of young. But we went there. Sheltering our children from the evil in the world is not one of those reasons. And I think today we are facing very bad effects of so many Christians who have pulled away from society, have kind of secluded themselves away, all in the name of being pure, pursuing purity, pursuing righteousness. And in the process, we've left society to its demise. So that's what it doesn't look like. Okay? What does it look like to hunger and thirst after righteousness? Well, it means that we don't back away from society and its ills, but that we run out of our church doors into it. It means that we give of ourselves to society, and that when we see injustice in society, that it bothers us, and we seek to correct it. It means that we can't stand the thought that there are people who do not know Jesus, and so we go to share him with them. It means that we have an insatiable desire to see God's kingdom advance on the kingdom of this world. And what does Jesus say will happen for those who hunger and thirst for righteousness in that way? He says that they will finally see it and will receive it in full one day. One day, that hunger will be satisfied. One day, they will no longer long to see the kingdom of God. One day, it'll be present in full. And I know that sometimes it can feel like that day is never coming, especially as you see evil's effects on the lives of those that are closest to you, who you love. But you can trust Jesus that it will come one day. But until that day, you know, let's not hide our faith. Let's show it to the world by the way that we bring Jesus into it. Let us hunger and thirst for righteousness. So today, if you are hungering and thirsting for righteousness, Jesus says to you, blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness. You will be satisfied. Now, verse 7. Jesus says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. And this beatitude is kind of straightforward. And yet I think that this is one that we have so often ignored in the church at large. In our quest for purity and clean living, we have often neglected the weightier matters of the law, such as justice, mercy, righteousness, faithfulness. And that is not a kind of a righteous life, but rather it's a fake righteousness. Luther once wrote, one of the virtues of counterfeit sanctity is that it cannot have pity or mercy for the frail and weak, but insists on the strictest enforcement and the purest selection. As soon as there's even a minor flaw, all mercy is gone, and there is nothing but fuming and fury. True justice shows mercy, but false justice shows indignation. True holiness is merciful and sympathetic, but all that false holiness can do is to rage and fume. In contrast to false holiness, a true Christian who believes in the importance of mercy for themselves continually pours out mercy on others who need it. They see how God has been merciful to them, and they seek to do likewise to those who need mercy but who don't deserve it. Today, if that is you, Jesus says to you, "Blessed are you, merciful ones, for you shall receive mercy." And then in verse 8, Jesus says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." Just by the way, have you been answering yes to all of these? what does it mean to be pure in heart? Well, this means much the same as what it means to hunger and thirst for righteousness. To be pure in heart means to not desire sin and to instead desire righteousness. But there's a further nuance here that I think is important to understand. And I have to just apologize to you guys. Last week was Reformation Sunday. I only gave you one Luther quote, and it was like 10 words. And that was wrong. So here's your third and final one, okay? And it's a long one to make up for that oversight. So anyways, Luther says this about what it means to be pure in heart. What is a pure heart, and what does it consist? The answer can be given quickly, and you don't have to climb up to heaven or run to a monastery for it and establish it with your own ideas. You should be on guard against any ideas that you call your own, as if they were just so much mud and filth. And you should realize that when a monk in the monastery is sitting in deepest contemplation, excluding the world from his heart altogether, and thinking about the Lord God the way he himself paints and imagines him, he is actually sitting, if you will pardon the expression, in the dung. Not up to his knees, but up to his ears. God, I love Luther. For he is proceeding on his own ideas without the word of God. And that is sheer deception and delusion. As Scripture testifies everywhere, what is meant by a pure heart is this: one that is watching and pondering what God says and replacing his own ideas with the word of God. This alone is pure before God. Yes, purity itself, which purifies everything that it includes and touches. So why are the pure in heart blessed? Because they will see God. Not just some imaginary God that they dream up, but the real God who has revealed himself to us in Scripture. So today, if you are pure in heart and you aren't imagining God in your own image and putting all those thoughts in your head, if you are that, Jesus says to you, "Blessed are you who are pure in heart, for you shall see God." Then in verse 9, Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." And what does it mean to be a peacemaker? Well, if you were a president or a foreign ruler, it means that you are to strive to make peace, even when you have a reason to go to war. None of you are rulers, I don't think, and so that doesn't really apply here, but the Beatitude still applies to us in other ways. For you and me to be a peacemaker today means for us to find the common ground with people, to find ways that you can work together for good. It means to reconcile feuding friends and spouses, to not sow division, but to sow people back together into bonds of fellowship. Jesus notes in the second part of his beatitude that there's something very God-like about being a peacemaker, something intrinsic to who God is about being a peacemaker. And so for us today, as we seek to live in this way, as we seek to be peacemakers, it means that we see the best in people, especially those that we disagree with, and that we relate to them not as enemies, but as people whom God loves. You know, we need to remember that there is no sin that someone can commit that removes completely the praiseworthy aspects that God has created them with. No one is beyond redemption. No one should be forever counted as an enemy. Everyone ought to be treated as though they can become allies. And so if you're doing that, if that's you today, Jesus says to you, "Blessed are you peacemakers, for you shall be called sons of God." And now verse 10 through 12, Jesus reaches the end of the Beatitudes with one that is much longer than the rest. He says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." So what should we know from this today? Perhaps the most important thing that we should take away from this beatitude is that we should come to expect persecution if we're going to be Christians. You know, I listened to the memorial service for Esther Werdahl here yesterday, and I was reminded from her life story as she was persecuted at the hands of the Chinese government of just how Christians have suffered abuse throughout history, and still are today. There's many Christians who have been persecuted in grotesque ways and have been murdered, been martyred for their faith. They've suffered incredible abuses simply because they haven't betrayed Christ, simply because they have held fast to Him. And while we are, at least for the moment, generally quite removed from the extreme persecution that is going on around the world, you know, in America, we have a ton of freedoms. We are facing it in part today. And we should come to expect it more in the future. You know, it might come through the hands of the government, from the rest of society. It can even come through the hands and mouths of fellow believers who lose their focus on the gospel. But regardless of who it comes from, as Christians, we should expect it. And so for us today, Jesus' message is both a reminder that we ought to expect persecution on account of following Him, and it's a comfort in the face of that persecution. Jesus tells you, you who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, that your reward is great and far surpasses anything that this life, anything that this world could throw our way. Now, we have just run through all those Beatitudes in kind of a fast way, even though it took a long time. As you've been doing it, I imagine that you likely kind of had the same response that I did as I studied them. Dang it. I'm not really any of those things. And if that's you, here's what I'm not going to tell you. I'm not going to tell you that that is okay. It is not okay for you to sin. It's not okay for you to live your life in a way contrary to God's command. It's not good for you. It's not good for anyone else. Instead, what I will say is, Jesus has come so that he might make you okay. He has come to make you righteous. He has come so that he might make you into this kind of person that this text is talking about. And while none of us will ever become exactly like this on this side of eternity, none of us will, this side of eternity, this is what God is slowly doing in us as we gather together around the Word and we're transformed by it. As we live with believers who are further along in that process. Really, what's happening here as we're gathered is that as we're transformed, we are becoming more beautiful the more that we look upon that which is beautiful. And I want you to think back with me to the question I asked you at the beginning of the sermon. Who is the most beautiful person you have ever met? Maybe now we can consider it in light of the language that Jesus uses here. Who is the most blessed person you have ever met? Who displays the goodness of God more than anyone you've ever met? Now, whoever that person is in this life, so long as you aren't merely focusing on physical beauty, but rather on the whole person, I'm sure that person exhibits a lot of the traits that we've talked about today, at least in small part. As I think about the most beautiful people that I know, I'm reminded of how they are humble, how they mourn over evil, how they don't insist on their own way, how they're not complacent in the face of evil, but give of themselves to answer it. See how they're merciful, how they passionately seek the Lord, how they make peace with others, how they've stood up for their faith even in the face of adversity. These sorts of people are truly beautiful. They're to be admired, and we should aspire to live like them. That's why we're covering this on All Saints Day, as we think back to those people who have become much more like this. Now, using this criteria for determining beauty, who is the most beautiful person of all? Who shows you God's goodness more than anyone else? Well, it would have to be that person that we come to worship, who, although he possessed everything, gave it all up so that he might give you the kingdom of heaven. It's that person who is so near to the brokenhearted that he came to earth to mourn with them so that they might be comforted one day. It's that person who had the right to destroy you for your rebellion against him, but withheld his judgment so that he might give you the eternal life that you did not deserve. It's that person who was so hungry and thirsty for you to be made righteous that he left the safety of heaven and came to this place of injustice called our home so that you might be made righteous in God's sight. It's that person who not only is just, but is so just that he is merciful towards you. It's that person who's not selfishly motivated, but is truly pure at heart. It's that person who came to make peace between you and God. It's that person who was persecuted by his creation, who was insulted, lied about, and ultimately killed for your sake. Who is the most beautiful person of all? That person that you have met, as you have heard him today? It's Jesus, of course. Sunday school answer. And today, this beautiful person, this person who has been blessed more than all, so that he might bless you, that person is calling you to put your trust in him and to see how he will make you more beautiful than you could possibly ever imagine. Let's pray. Father, thank you for blessing us through Jesus. And Lord, your description of what we ought to be is daunting and is something that we can't achieve. And so, Lord, we ask that you would make us into that. And Lord, we trust that you are in the process of doing that through your word. Trust that you are making beautiful people out of us, as people who are not beautiful on our own. We trust that. We ask that you would continue to build that trust in us towards you. And we thank you for forgiving us for when we fail. In your name we pray. Amen.